The 2018 NBA draft is pretty insane. Of course, Luka Doncic and Trae Young are both incredibly good players already. And then there are later picks made like Jaren Jackson Jr., Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, and Michael Porter Jr. But none of these guys were the number one pick. While Luka Doncic should have been the number one overall pick, the guy who was selected number one overall was DeAndre Ayton, and you may or may not have noticed that he really is not talked about all that much. And the reason for this is really just that he has been disappointing. Ayton by no means is a bust. Don't think anybody would make that argument. But to say that he has exceeded expectations or really even met expectations would pretty much just be false. Ayton as a prospect got comparisons to the likes of David Robinson, a really big guy who would be dominant in the paint and a really good defensive player and overall just a perennial all-star and franchise player. This year, being that the Suns are better than they have been pretty much ever since I became an NBA fan, I have caught a lot more Suns games than really ever before. And while the team overall is just really good and really fun to watch, I also can't help but watch DeAndre Ayton in these games and feel rather disappointed that he has basically been relegated to a role player. So the question in the title of today's video is not really what this video is about, because the answer to the question, is DeAndre Ayton a disappointment? The answer is yes. But today I want to explore why that is, because part of the reason why he is disappointing isn't his fault, and part of the reason is his fault. So I wanted to explore this. So why is DeAndre Ayton a disappointment? Let's talk about it. Before I continue on with this video, about half of the people that watch these videos are not subscribed, so if you fall into that 50%, then subscribe. Also drop a like on this video, it only takes 1 second and it makes a massive difference. Let's look at Ayton's career numbers thus far to kind of paint a picture of where he is right now. He has averaged 16 points and 11 rebounds on 60% true shooting over about 150 games. Now, these numbers are by no means bad, which is why I say no one really is claiming Ayton to be a bust, because it's not like he is putting up unimpressive numbers. It's just a matter of those numbers living up to what he could be, on top of the fact that when you look at his stats this year in particular, his numbers have dipped to worse than his rookie year. It appears as though, offensively at least, he has had very little improvement. And being that 75% of his shots are assisted, that makes his 16 points for his career look even less significant. When you compare his last 3 year numbers to Clint Capella's, he's actually falling short a bit, because Clint averages 15 and 13 on 63% true shooting. And being that Clint Capella is a better defensive player, a better rebounder, and averages just one less point on better efficiency, it's kind of sad that DeAndre Ayton is on a Clint Capella tier right now when he should be amongst the best centers in the NBA at this point. So in the numbers department, there's no doubt that Ayton is falling short. Now, I will say, though his offense hasn't really improved, his defense has gotten significantly better from what it was in his rookie year. Ayton's defense was pretty overrated coming into the NBA, and then when he was in the NBA, it wasn't very good, but now I'd say Ayton is a plus defender. Not as much of a plus defender as you would like, because you look at his physical profile and think that guy could be phenomenal defensively because he's big and can be intimidating around the basket, but he's also not a slow lumbering big by any means. But regardless, it is an improvement and it is worth noting. But as for why his offense has stagnated and his numbers have stagnated, well, there's two reasons. One of them is Ayton's fault and one of them isn't. As for the one that's not his fault, well, the Phoenix Suns have yet to embrace Ayton really at all. In his rookie year, he got less shots than TJ Warren, Kelly Oubre, and barely got more shots per game than Josh Jackson. Which, that's very questionable. Like, this is your number one overall pick and you're not a winning team anyways. Why is Josh Jackson shooting the ball almost as much as DeAndre Ayton? Makes no damn sense. His second year was better. He was second in attempts, but by 0.1, as Kelly Oubre basically shot the same amount of shots, which is fine enough because Kelly is a good offensive player and not hard on the eyes. But he should still not be shooting more than DeAndre Ayton. Granted, Ayton only played about 35 games in his second year because of PED use, so the actual shots per game when Ayton is playing is less easy to find. But roughly speaking, Ayton was not shooting as much as you would probably like for someone of his caliber. And then in his third season, when Chris Paul was added to the roster, I was really hopeful that this would mean that Ayton finally breaks out. A lot of people were talking about what Chris means for Booker, but for me, the biggest thing was, what does DeAndre Ayton do that Chris Paul can benefit? Because, I mean, Chris Paul made DeAndre Jordan an all-NBA first-team player somehow. So he's clearly beneficial to big men. But no, Ayton's numbers have regressed to below his rookie year, and this year, he's barely getting more shots than Mikal Bridges and Jay Crowder. So the Suns have not exactly been like, oh, Ayton, go for it, you're our guy. Like, just not at all. It makes sense that he is second fiddle to Devin Booker, but he's not even really second fiddle to Devin Booker. He's getting less shots than Chris Paul and barely shooting more shots than Jay Crowder. That's a problem. But the blame cannot all be placed on the Phoenix Suns, because while I want to be nice to DeAndre Ayton, another huge factor here is his mentality. He's really not aggressive for someone who has the talent and physical attributes that he does, because first of all, Ayton barely posts up in comparison to what his potential post-up wise is, and when he does, he seems to lean more towards being a finesse big trying to bust out a fancy move, rather than being a power big and just bullying down low. When coming into the draft, and what was seen a lot in Arizona, was that he could be a bully ball big. Bully, say that three times fast, but it hasn't been the case thus far. He did play at Arizona, right? I'm not mixing up colleges. I'm like 90% sure it was Arizona. I really hope it is. Ayton does not really impose upon people in the paint. Like, he is 6'11", 250, but he might as well play like he's 6'8", 220. He does not bully people around the basket. He does not like go into contact. He really just takes the easiest attempts he can get for the most part, and then when he's in the post, it's these deep hook shots or fadeaways, or often he does a face up and shoots a mid-range shot. And it's like, dude, it's not like he doesn't possess those skills to some degree or another, but you would not want that to be the foundation of his game when he has the physical attributes to be physically dominant. This has led as well to incredibly low free throw attempt numbers, which is significantly holding back his numbers, because for his career, he averages about 2.5 free throw attempts per game. When you compare that to the likes of David Robinson that he was compared to coming into the draft, for his prime, he shot 10 free throws a game. For Joel Embiid's prime, he has shot 9 free throws a game. He's another big that got some comparisons with Jordan, with Ayton, not Jordan, different DeAndre. So he's not being physical at all, like just point blank period. That's not something he is doing. Now, I don't know if this stems from a fear of contact or just a complete lack of aggressiveness. If I had to guess, I'd probably say it's the second one, but regardless, it's a huge problem. Ayton has all the talent in the world. He's just not really using it. Now, also, Ayton has all the talent in the world and the Suns are not treating him like it, but it's a combination of these two factors that has led to DeAndre Ayton being a really disappointing player thus far. And this is unfortunate, because I was really high on DeAndre Ayton going into the 2018 draft. Now, take that with a grain of salt, because I am horrible with draft takes, especially the 2018 draft. Don't know if you've seen this tweet before, if Rudy is inclined to pull it up, but I'm not great with draft stuff, so take that with a grain of salt. But I really like DeAndre Ayton going into the draft, and it's kind of unfortunate that he has just been relegated to Clint Capella, which is like, that's just unfortunate. Now, part of that is because of the mentality, part of that is the Suns, but regardless, I want to see it changed. As for how it can change or if it will, well, first of all, the Suns thing, that's out of Ayton's control. It's just a matter of the team giving him that embrace. But also, DeAndre needs to be more assertive, and I'm curious what this is going to look like, being that Ayton is up for extension relatively soon. He could be worthy of a max contract, but he's not playing like he is right now, and if he wants to get that money, he might start being more assertive. It's really up to him. But yeah, that's it. Shout out to Rudy for editing this video. That is the end of this video. Please be sure to like and subscribe for more NBA content like this, and cue the outro music.